Hello. Welcome to lecture 37, which is housing and real estate development. So far, we have discussed all the housing typologies, how those typologies can be integrated in the preparation of the city housing strategy. And in the last day, we discussed the disaster management and its implication in housing strategy and planning. We discussed that disasters can be divided into two parts, the natural disaster and man-made disasters. For the disasters, we can take structural interventions and non-structural interventions. The structural interventions are basically physical. We can construct building or any physical element, and whereas the non-structural interventions are related to social, cultural, psychological or mental. And we also discussed that to take the interventions which is related to housing, we have to take the actions before the disaster, during the disaster and post disaster, after the disaster is over. So, at every level we can take the action, like at the pre-disaster situation we can formulate the plans, we can take the development, we can formulate the development controls, we can enforce them. And during the disaster and post disaster, during the disaster we need to take action. Basically basic job is the operation, evacuation, all those kind of job. And in the post disaster we have to make the reconstruction of the building, the housing areas and the reconstruction of the basic infrastructure, that is the job. And also we mentioned that as per the Disaster Management Act 2005, it is the duty and responsibility for every city authority to prepare the city disaster management plan. It is the duty of the regional planning authorities or the district planning authority to integrate the disaster management and mitigation inside their planning. And with this, we concluded last discussion that we can integrate this element of the disaster management at city planning level and the housing strategy, and also in the other sectoral planning like mobility and the solid waste management or the sanitation. Every aspect of planning should be integrated with the disaster management aspect, because this is very, very important aspect which ensures the safety of the people. Now, today we will discuss another very important aspect of the housing development, that is real estate development. Now, why it is important? So far whatever we discussed, we started this the series of lecture with the policy discussion. Now, policy is very, very important, because policy basically gives a long term guidelines, long term direction for the city, that how the city will grow in particular sector. So, we discussed in details. Then we came to the planning level. We discussed the planning at the regional level, at the city level, and how the city level planning could be done for each typology, like formal housing, informal housing, organic housing, various types of housing typologies. And now, after the planning, we have to planning is not the sufficient. After the planning and the design, we have to implement the project. So, when you try to implement, the housing projects based on your housing strategy, because after the housing strategy is framed, you have a clear direction, clear physical map of the city showing the various pockets, land pockets, indicating the typical housing typologies and prospective kind of types of developer, private or joint ventures or public or NGO, what kind of developers are there. So, now how you will include the developer in the implementation phase, so that they can complete the project, they can construct the project and help you as a public authority to take you or to reach you in the target areas, which is the vision for the housing strategy. So, implementation is a very, very important part. So, for the implementation, we will be discussing that from a planning paradigm, how we basically come to a development paradigm. Now, in the so far in the planning paradigm, it is a theoretical construct. Typical analysis and prescription, but it leads to be implemented which is a part of development. Now, who will develop? Who will develop this? Who will construct the building? Basically, it is done by some developer. So, here the major role of developer comes. Developer. So, this developer could be private, this could be public. The public developers are basically developers like town and country planning authority, developers like housing boards or any infrastructure development authority, any smart city development authority. So, all of they basically act as a developer, and also there could be joint ventures company. Joint venture company, which is nothing but the combination of the public and the private. There could be agencies like NGO or community based organization. They also can act like a developer. So, developer's role, what is the role of the developer? Now, let us discuss that what the developer do during the development. Developer's role is multifarious. What they do? The first job of a developer. So, role of developer. First job what a developer does is first assemble land, because in the housing strategy we have clearly indicated that which land is to be developed in what manner. So, what is the final FAR, what is the typology, whether group housing or plotted housing or cooperative housing, we have indicated. So, based on that prescription, a developer can purchase the land from the market, they can acquire with the government if it is a joint venture property, guided development, that they can do whatever is the method, they can assemble land. After that, their job is to conceptualize the development, what kind of development it will be, whether it will be high rise, low rise, mid rise, with the help of any technical personnel. Then mobilize resource. Then take permission from the government authority. Then construction. After the construction, they have to sell the amount. Sell the units. So, construction, and then we call it disposal, then facilitate the occupancy of the unit to the end users. And so, these are the limit of the range of works which is done by a developer. So, during the conceptualized phase, they might have to go for a market research to exactly find out what kind of typologies will be required or has the market demand. So, within the overall city planning strategy, they can plan and construct, plan, design and construct and then dispose the units. Now, sometimes what they do, a bigger developer, they can take up to this portion, and the construction and disposal could be given to some other agencies to conduct. So, that also could be done. So, in those cases, those who are only involved in the construction, disposal and occupancy, they are called builder. So, basically builder's job is to construction and in some cases disposal the units and ensure the occupancy, whereas the developers role is to do every stage. They can do from 1 to 7 all the works the developer can execute, but in some cases they can execute up to some level and then the builders can take up, but otherwise a developer can do every stages of the job. So that is the developer job. So developer's role is to realize the plan and strategy. So it is the developers who bring our plan and strategy in a real form, in a physical form. We can see the buildings, we can see the cities. So it is very important to appreciate and to recognize that fact, that a developer need to they realize, they make the plan and strategy real on ground in a physical form. So based on that, so we have to understand that the developer's role is not very minimal. They have a role, a very vital role in creating our city and the housing. Now what kind of property or what kind of property or units they develop? Before I come to the overall network, how the developer and the planner and the government works, let us see that what kind of property developers consider for development. So at this moment we are bringing one term, which is property. So property is equal to, is basically the house unit, house or land unit plus ownership. So that means any house units or land, if you have the ownership, legal ownership, it becomes a property. So they are more involved in the property development. It is not the development of only infrastructure or only housing units. It is the development of the property development, which is called as real estate development. Though in this lecture or in this lecture series there is not much scope to discuss about the real estate development, but please take a note that it is the part of the development which comes after the planning and the strategy. So they deal with the property, which is nothing but the housing and house and land units plus the ownership. Now what kind of properties are there? Now property can be divided into various forms, like it can be freehold, like a property can be owned by people for entire lifespan, so that is called freehold. The freehold property ensures the freedom to purchase, to sell, to give rent, to give on lease, everything, and to addition and make the addition and alteration and modification within the property, within the overall development control framework. But there could be properties like leasehold. In the leasehold property, the ownership is given up for some time, like say 30 years or 40 years. It is definitely long term lease, like it can be 99 years also. And in leasehold premises or the property, some of the freedom or some of the actions could be restricted by the giver or by the developer. That is possible. And also there could be rental, which is by and large is a type of leasehold, but rental houses basically is mean less duration of the ownership. Now based on that, the property, so for developing a property or developing a housing project, it is not only developer who are involved, there are a lot of other stakeholders who are involved, like government, like the financier, like the small developers, owner, the technical persons like architects and planners. Now let us see that how a development takes place, all the people who are associated with the development, how they are associated. So in the center, we can keep a developer right. The first stakeholders with whom the developer is associated is the government agency. So, from the government, the developer gets the approval, sanctions, based on the housing strategy, based on the development control, they get the approval of a project to design that project, and in return they can provide some sanction fees or taxes. Like, but a developer may not have the adequate finances, they may take a loan or borrowing. When we discuss the housing finance, we discuss that there could be institutional finance. The objective of the institutional finance is to provide loan to the developer to develop the housing project. So, there could be financer whose objective will be so financier can provide them some loan or finance, okay. In return they will get some interest. On the other hand, there could be other partner, financial partner, who also can leverage some amount of the finance and resources with that particular developer. So, here they can provide also finance, and in return they will share the profit or loss. Now, basic difference between a partner, financial partner, and a regular financier like say housing finance institution or bank is that both of them they provide the finance, but they share the profit and loss, but they do not share the profit and loss, they are only interested to get the interest at the market rate or at the rate which is contracted. And then there are technical persons, technical group. Within the technical group there are architects, engineers, market specialists who basically provide the knowledge with some fees, consultancy fees or any advisory fees. And also there could be builders or small developers. So, their job is to construct or dispose some unit, and they can provide some amount of they can construct some unit, and in return they can get some profit, they can share profit. And another part is that the end user, so we have the end user who are getting the housing unit in the end. So, end user get the housing unit, get the house, and they are giving the price. They can get the house from the builder also in some cases, that is also possible like this, and also they can give the price to the builder or the small developer. On the other hand, the financial partners and the financing organization, they are also controlled by government. So, there is also a control. So, this is the network and the network that how a housing and the real estate development takes place, and these are the major stakeholders in terms of the government, financial partners, finance or institution, small developers and builders, technical group and end user. In short, this is called as real estate administrative model, in short REAM. It basically shows that how the various stakeholders acts in a integrated manner. Now, by and large in India, the real estate market and the dynamics of the market players are not very much organized, and it is in fact rather it is very much unorganized. So, to organize the unorganized real estate market or the housing development market and to bring more transparency and accountability. Now, what transparency and accountability means to a end customer or end user? The transparency and accountability related to end users or the customer is that they will get their committed house and the whole transaction will be so transparent that they are clear on their on what they are going to get at the end of the housing construction and what they are going to provide as a part of the price, number one. And number two, there should be an accountable service by the developer. If a developer commits that within 3 years the housing will be completed, so within 3 years they have to complete it, and otherwise they have to incur the rent or the penalty. So this kind of transparency and accountability was not there in Indian housing development and real estate sector. To enhance the transparency and accountability, Government of India, they have come up with real estate regulation act, in short RERA. This act, the objective of this act is to enhance the transparency and accountability. So, some of the proposal or some of the provisions under the act I should mention to you, remaining you can refer the act in your own time. So, number one provision what the act tells that every state authority has to provide, has to frame a real estate regulation authority. So, this regulation authority, the job of the regulatory authority will be ensure the right of the end users and the buyer. Various means are provided to ensure that. The one of the means are that every developer has to deposit some amount of money before the any construction starts as a security deposit or as security money. And not only that, they have to register on the authority as a developer. And not only that, they have to disclose all the sanctions and the approvals they have received so far before going for further construction and further development. And then some of the other, as a part of the transparent practices, the developer has to disclose to the buyers about the net carpet area which is usable by the end user, not the super built up area or built up area, because super built up area and built up area is sometimes not understandable, not perceivable by the end user. It is the carpet area which is understandable by the people. So, in terms of carpet area and all the approvals, okay, and all the time periods. So, if they cannot deliver the projects, there will be penalty. penalty so that the end users get the benefit of the this Real Estate Regulation Act. Now, after this act, every state government has to frame this regulatory body which will regulate the real estate market in every state. But some of the states they have already formulated this body, but most of the state they have framing of this body. So after this Real Estate Regulation Act is implemented in every state, every city, we can expect that at least some amount of real estate development and housing development will be done in a transparent way. The transaction will be transparent, end users will be benefited, and end users will get the affordable housing within a quicker time. So today we discussed a very important part of the housing planning and strategy, that is the real estate development. We talked about the planning so far till last class. Now today we have discussed the very important part which is related to development, and with the development we brought the term of a developer. A developer is a agency or organization or a group of people who assembles land, develops the land, develops the infrastructure, do the market research, conceptualize a project with the help of the technical personnel, then they take the permissions and the approval with the help of the architect and the planner, and after getting the approval they mobilize the resource from the lending agencies or from the financing agencies, then they construct by themselves or sometimes they construct by some builders, and then they dispose the units either through lottery system or through first come first serve basis, and then they facilitate the occupancy. So this is the series of the work of the developer. So developer is the agency who ultimately shapes our city based on the planning and strategy. So planning and strategy is a prescription, and developer makes the prescription real. So we have to be vigilant, we have to be also answerable and accountable for any development works. Now in this discussion we discussed about real estate model, where we discussed the role of government, role of financier, role of partners, role of builders, role of end users and technical group, and then we mentioned about the Real Estate Regulatory Act in which came up last 1 or 2 years, government by Government of India. This act provides the mandate to formulate the real estate regulatory authority at central level, state level, and also to ensure the transparency and accountability. As a part of the transparency and accountability, every developer has to register under that this authority with some security deposit, and they have to disclose all the approvals and all the details of the project before going to any sale or any advertisement for the project. And not only that, as a part of transparent process, they have to disclose all the informations including the area in carpet area to the end users, and not only that, there are penalty clause so that if they do not deliver the project within the stipulated time, they have to provide the penalty to the end users. So Real Estate Regulatory Development and Regulatory Act will ensure the more transparent and accountable services and development of the city as far as the housing and the real estate is concerned. So with this note, we conclude this discussion. In the next discussion, we will discuss how a housing project is managed. We discuss the development. After the development, once the housing project is constructed, how it is managed with some of the agencies and the developer. That part also we discussed in the next class. So for today, we thank you for your participation.